Hey, what's good? We're gonna make this video. Try to make it a little bit quick, because that battery is going down. And I wasn't trying to charge it, because I was trying to get this video done early in the morning here. So today, we're gonna switch it up a little bit, make this video a little bit more funky than the last ones. We're gonna talk about the beginnings of feminism here. I live in California, so it's a very interesting topic considering the current times we live in. And I'm gonna talk about Mary Wollstonecraft. I don't know if you've heard that name, or you probably haven't even heard of some of the novels that she was responsible for writing, but these novels have had a very, and her life too, her life and these novels have had a pretty big impact coming down the line of the past, we'll say 150 years of history here in the world in general. I mean, I was gonna say the United States, but this one was actually British. She wasn't even American, so like you can just see how much of an impact this had on the world to the point where like I even think she's from this country when she's not. The British always, they're usually in front of these movements. At least they were when they had the cultural hegemony. But I guess America now has the cultural hegemony, so that's an interesting topic. But yeah, Mary Wollstonecraft. She was in the 18th century, so this is like late 1700s, like where she was most active. English author / philosopher, who is basically the mother of modern feminism, although she would have kind of scoffed. She would have been like, what is that term? Because that wasn't really a term when she was doing a thing. And she was really smart. I'll say that just from reading about her and reading her books. I've read half of her second book. Like her second really important book that I'll talk about. I read like half of that. I'll go over them more in depth when I read all of them, but her first really important book that she's best known for is A Vindication of the Rights of Women. So this was written in 1792. And in it, she argues that women are not naturally inferior to men, because this was a common thought among like the intelligentsia, I guess you would say, like the intelligent people of the day, or the intelligent men, right? They thought that women were naturally inferior to men, but she argued that they were not naturally inferior to men, but they only appeared to be due to a lack of education. So that's important. And I say, you know, thinking about today, most people who are in charge of education are actually women, if you think about it in terms of the direct work of education. Like, think of your K-12 teachers, and think of actually your average university, you know. Like, nowadays they're 60% plus women and 40% minus men, so that's definitely not how it was back in her day. So, you know, that's part of the impact. And I have a little side note how boys are turning to the internet to get educated these days, and that is going to be interesting coming in the future. And hopefully that's, right now it's pretty rocky, but hopefully it smooths out in the future. And she wrote this novel in response to the effects that the French Revolution had on the British society to the north. So the French Revolution took place also in the late 1700s, if I remember that correctly from school. Like 1790s, I'm thinking like Robespierre, and then Napoleon comes in like in the early 1800s and kind of like says, okay, like kind of takes charge and becomes emperor essentially. So she's kind of writing this like in that French Revolution period. So that had a large impact on the British society and the thought that they had in terms of the gender dynamics, and honestly a lot of different things, but especially like gender dynamics. And that many of the day they believed that in Britain, like, it seemed like the French were kind of trying to like level out society and like make things more orderly. And then she, it seems like she kind of wanted some of that thought to like move north, or she looked at that and said, hey, some of this should, like, some of this thought process should be like adopted a little bit to the British society. Because many of the people in that day in Britain, they said they believed that women should only receive a domestic education, and they should only prepare for housekeeping and marriage. Where in Wollstonecraft, she saw this as limiting to women, both socially, intellectually, and sexually. She saw this as limiting and repressing women, so that's important. And then this book, The Vindication of Rights of Women, was very well received. Very well received upon its publication in her own society. And I didn't look this up, but probably the society, like the other European countries around, might have received this novel well as well. But I didn't look into that, so I can't speak on that. But I know in her society they received this one well. But her second novel, which is actually the one I'm kind of reading right now, her second well-known novel is called Maria or the Wrongs of Women. And that's just a very interesting title considering our first one. Like I said, she's pretty smart. This one was written as a sequel to The Vindication of the Rights of Women. It was published actually after her death though, so she wrote it as a sequel, but she didn't publish it, probably for a good reason. And she died, so then her widower is the one that published all of her like manuscripts that she wrote, and you know, it was enough for like a pretty lengthy novel. And she died in 1797, and the book was published in 1798. So where the rights of women was largely focused on the intellectual and the rational kind of thought process, The Wrongs of Women was focused more on like the emotional, the passion, and the sentimental. And that's an important word. That was an important, like, sentimentalism was an important, actually branch of science, pretty much, like, had to do with the nerves and whatnot that they kind of practiced and believed in that time. But then it kind of, that's like one of those things that kind of like didn't make it to the modern day. So the whole sentimentalism thing, people kind of stopped believing in it after a while, but then at this time, it was more widely accepted. I think it might have been on its way out actually during the time, but it was definitely way more widely accepted than it is now. Now it kind of, I think ultimately it kind of meshed into some of the science that we practice today, but they kind of took some of the more, like some of the parts that made sense, and discarded a lot of like the other parts that didn't make sense, kind of like how people do with most things. But yeah, my next bullet, where the rights of women was more about how women might collectively raise themselves up in intellectual society. The Wrongs of Women was more about how women collectively held themselves down when it came to intellectual society. So she believed that women had the power to raise themselves up, and also they had the power to bring themselves down. And then she kind of detailed the way that she thought, as like a whole, women were like holding themselves, like holding each other down. So she didn't even really blame men as much. Like when you kind of analyze the text, she was definitely talking about like kind of how like women have the power to raise themselves up or bring themselves down, and it's up to them to kind of determine which one they want to take, which path they want to take. Like I said, I mean, she was pretty smart. And this is definitely a precursor to like the kind of like the first part of feminism, like the first to where they wanted to kind of raise up the intellectual, raise up the political power of the women. This was like Mary Wollstonecraft was definitely a forerunner to that whole like intellectual movement and political movement of like women trying to gain like power in like a social organized setting, if that makes sense. And this one was actually received very poorly in the society of its day. And I don't know if they, obviously, I mean, I have a bird's eye view of the thing, but I don't know if they saw the whole like picture she was trying to paint, because this is supposed to be a sequel to her last book. I really think she was kind of exploring both sides of the, as a woman, she was exploring both sides of like the intellectual and the emotional, which I don't think is necessarily a bad thing. But when this one book is taken alone, then you might not get the whole perspective of what she was, like the picture she was trying to paint. And I think that's kind of what happened in terms of like how they took the book. And then she was dead too when it was published, so she couldn't really, you know, I don't want to say defend herself, but like she couldn't really explain what kind of she meant. And then also, like, was she, you know, they were manuscripts, like, so I don't know how done she was with it, because she didn't publish it herself. So yeah, there's that. But ultimately, this book wasn't really picked back up until the feminist movement, like some 50 years later. So maybe by then they kind of had more of a bird's eye picture, because originally when this book was published, most people kind of just bashed on like her life, like the life she lived, rather than analyzing the book, I think. Because in this day, a lot of times the books were somewhat autobiographical. Authors would be somewhat autobiographical, and that was normal. And they really kind of took that autobiographical thing to like an extreme, I think, when they analyzed the book. And then, you know, given the fact that she was dead, that didn't help. But I really think if you look at the whole picture she was trying to paint, seeing this as a sequel to the Vindication of the Rights of Women, then it kind of becomes a more interesting picture. Yeah, but that's what the bird's eye view of it. And like I said, I'll go over these novels each in depth in later videos once I fully read both of them. But yeah, because I think that's interesting. And then also, my last bullet here, Mary Wollstonecraft had a daughter named Mary Shelley, who wrote a novel entitled Frankenstein. And honestly, I read that on Wikipedia, so I have to look more into that, but that's pretty freaking crazy, in my opinion. That's kind of wild, because Mary Shelley wrote Frankenstein, and that's, you all know that novel. That's a big story that's even honestly told and like a reshape to this day. So, I mean, you want to talk about like the impact on society, I think that's a pretty big impact. But yeah, we'll leave it there for now. I'll probably do a few videos on the beginnings of feminism, because I think that's interesting in today's day and age. But yeah, that's pretty much it. All right, yep, stay healthy. That's all I got to say for today. I'll catch y'all later.